Hey everybody, my name is Lyndon, and in this tutorial I'm going to demonstrate how to use the stroke effect to do another type of text reveal. So what we're going to do, first of all, make a new comp, 1920 by 1080, 30fps. I'm going to go 300 frames on this one, click OK, set it up to 100%, and then we just need to make some text. So the way this effect is going to work is we need to have masks or a vector. And with the stroke effect, it's going to be able to trace the outlines of that mask. So to do that with text, just right click over the text object, right click, go to create mask from text. Then if we toggle on our mask visibility and then click the M key, you can see that each letter has at least one mask on it. So we've got L, E, T, T, E, and R. And then for R, since there's some negative space here, grab this and then pull that out. You can see that the first mask is actually just defining that overall shape of R, and the second mask there is cutting out that little hole. So just keep that in mind for this next part that we're going to do in a second. I'm going to close that and then add the stroke effect. So by default, this is going to do one mask at a time. You want to set that to all masks. And this is very similar to Photoshop's stroke effect. So if we change the color to something that has a little bit more contrast and then increase the brush size, you can see that's basically just tracing the outline of the mask. And that's great. Sometimes that's all you want. And then from here, you can have controls for like the start and end, for example, and you can animate that stroke going over the edges. But where this becomes a lot more interesting is changing the paint style. So if we say on transparent and then do the same thing, just animate this end percentage, it looks like it's being written. So you could animate like a pen going over this and make it look like it's actually writing the letters, or a hand or something. And you could also do reveal original image. So if you composited this with a texture, it would reveal the texture as well. So I'm going to change that back to on transparent. So in a moment, what we're going to do is separate each letter on its own layer. And that's going to be a little bit time consuming. But when we do that, we'll have full control. However, if we have each layer with a separate stroke effect on it, and then later on we want to change the brush size, or brush hardness, or opacity, or whatever, you'd have to go through each layer and change it individually. So we need to be able to create a master stroke effect that will be able to control all the layers. So the way that we're going to do that is right click on your composition, go to new, null object, and then we're going to call this layer master control. And on the master control layer, we're going to grab a stroke effect. And this stroke effect on the master doesn't do anything. All it does is act as the settings for the stroke effect on all these other layers that we're going to have. So we're going to do this on the first one right now. Click E to open up the stroke effect. You can open up the full stack there and do the same thing. E and open up stroke. So we need to link the child to the parent, okay? So we're going to skip color for now, and then I'm going to hold down the Alt key on brush size, then grab the pick whip and drag it up here to the brush size on our master control. You can see that's the master control. We can do the same thing for brush hardness. Click the numpad enter key. Hold down the Alt key again for opacity. Grab opacity, enter. We can't do it for the start, we can't do it for the end. Otherwise, they're all going to start at the same time, no matter where they are. And the idea of having them on a separate layer is so we can offset the animations. You could also do spacing though. And you could do paint style as well. So when you do paint style, since this is on original image, this one now changes to on original image too. I click on transparent. I'm going to pull this up a little bit too. So now anytime that we make a change down here, like if I change the brush size to be 10, you can see it's going to be 10 here. And these red numbers indicate that they're driven by an expression. So anytime that you'd want to control these, you wouldn't come down here to the individual layer to do it. You would do it at this master control level. Okay, so for the next part, if we want to be able to randomize the color on each layer, we need to set up a separate expression for that. So hold down the Alt key, click the stopwatch for color, and we're going to create a few lines of code. I'm going to backspace this and enter down a few times. So the way that the color attribute works is it's basically an array of four different values. So we have values for RGB and alpha. So we need to create our custom variables that each one will be assigned a random number. So to do that, we're just going to call one variable r and then say equals. And to grab the expression, we're just going to click this little arrow here, go up to random numbers, and then random min max, this one. So for the minimum value, we're just going to say a value of 0. This is going to be floating point numbers. And then here, a value of 1. So that's going to choose any number between 0 and 1, like a decimal point number. Then click the semicolon key, and then we're going to enter down. I'm going to do g equals, and then you can just grab that same random part and copy and paste that in. And then we're going to do one for B as well. If you wanted to be able to control the alpha independently, like if you wanted to have an opacity control, you could do that as well. But for this, we're not going to do that. And I'm going to pull this down so we can see a little bit more. And then to assign the new array, we're going to open up the bracket. Then we're going to say R, comma, G, comma, B, comma, 1. And 1 stands for alpha at being 100%. So there's not going to be any transparency. And then from there, you can just click the numpad enter key, and you can see that we've got a random color, which is great. There is one problem though. So if we start scrubbing through this, you can see that every frame is changing colors. So to fix that, to get a static number for these random numbers, we have to go all the way to the top and then grab another expression called seed random. So what the seed is going to do is going to define how this is creating the random numbers. So the seed is going to determine what numbers are calculated. So to do that, we assign a number, but we want each one to be different. So we're going to assign it the index. So the index is the number of the layer. So then since each layer has a different number assigned to it, each seed is going to be different. And then for the second part where it says timeless, false, we actually do want this to be timeless because we are looking for a static number. So we're simply going to type in true and then click off. So now when we scrub through it, you can see that there's no change. Okay, so this has to be done before we copy this a bunch of times. And then now there's one other effect we're going to add. It's going to be a hue and saturation control. And we're going to do the same thing with the hue and saturation as we did up here. So in the master control, we're going to grab another hue and saturation and call this master hue saturation. So this master hue saturation will control the hue and saturation on this layer. So click E and then click E again, open up hue and saturation, do the same thing here, E and then E again, open up master saturation. Okay, so down here, there's only one channel that we need, even though that there appears to be multiple. All of these attributes are actually linked to this channel range. So on the child layer, hold down the Alt key on the stopwatch, then grab the pick whip and attach it to the channel range on the master control. Then click the numpad enter key. So now if we go to the master control, to the master hue saturation, we can then change the hue, we can change the saturation, and that would control all those layers independently. Controls you that for now. The one last thing before we copy this a bunch of times, we need to go up and we need to animate the start or end areas. So you can do this in a number of different ways. You could have it animate backwards or forwards, but for me, I'm just gonna start it at 0. And I'm gonna go to frame 30, and you'll see why in a moment, but I'm gonna give it a little bit of padding at the beginning. Then click the stopwatch for end. Then I'm going to go forward to frame 100 and then increase that to 100%. So between 30 and 100, it's going to take 3 seconds and each letter is going to be written fully. So at this point, now we're ready to copy the letter tracing outlines. And we're going to leave one of these untouched. So this one that we have here, I'm going to rename this to be the reference. So this is in case we make a mistake and we need our masks back, because the next part is we need to have 14 different duplicate copies of this, and then we go layer by layer and delete all the masks that we don't need. So this part is a little long-winded, but I'll show you the first few. I'm going to pull this back down. So let's duplicate this. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14. Okay, so starting at the top, click the M key. This is going to be our letter L. So we're going to rename this L. And then L, we can look at the mask for L and delete all the other masks. So just hold down the shift key, select all the other masks, and simply delete them. So if I solo L, L is just on its own. Then we go to the next letter. This is going to be E. Click M. We delete L because we already have L, and then we need E, but select all the masks beside E and then delete them. So you just go layer by layer and delete all the masks except for the layer, except for the masks that make up the letter on that specific layer. Most letters are only going to have a single mask, but depending on the font you're using and depending on the letter itself, some letters like R and A are going to have two different masks because one is for the main shape and one is for the negative space. So be sure to leave both of those on for those. So I'm going to go ahead and skip through the rest. Okay, so now I have all of my letters on separate layers. If we go all the way to the beginning, we can see that each one is coming on. They're still at the same time, but now what we can do, we can offset these animations. There's one more thing that we're going to do before we do that. And this is totally up to you. You can do whatever you want with this, but it's kind of cool if we made this into 3D text. So if we click on our switch for the 3D icon, then they're all going to now be in 3D. So what we can do, click the P key, animate the position, and then start the Z position at -2500, somewhere around there. Maybe a little bit further, maybe -3000, so they're behind the camera. And then we can have them come forward, and then by frame 100, they land, or perhaps frame 120. So they're gonna just go from behind the camera and then come forward. And then what we could do is go into the graph editor and then separate the dimensions here. So each channel is going to be separate. We don't even really care about X and Y position. Select the end keyframes, ease them out, and then select the front keyframes and then just pull the handle up. So they're going to get faster at the beginning and then slow down. Okay, so at this point, we don't have the letters coming on until frame 30. So close the graph editor, click the U key, and then just marquee select all the keyframes for the end position, and we'll just pull those forward just a little bit. We'd like to be able to see those towards the beginning. Something more like this. And there's so many things you could do with this. This is just one idea. I'll do Control A and then close them all. Okay, so here's the main thing. This is why we separated all these layers. We're going to start offsetting these. And you can offset them in any way, but you can do it in order if you want to. You can, like, leave E where it is, select everything else, and then maybe offset at 10 frames, and then control select the next one, and then the next one. So now each letter is going to be 10 frames after the previous one. And you could do the inverse for tracing, or you can just completely randomize it and have all the letters come on any which way. It's just a lot of different ways that you could do this. For this, I'm just going to do this a pretty simple animation and then just see what that looks like. So this is one idea. Maybe it's a little bit slow, but at this point, they're all separate, so you can play around with this. You could speed them up if you wanted to. And if you go to your master control, now we can decide what hardness we want or what size we want. So we can do something like 4, and that's going to be a lot brighter. Or you can maybe do halfway, maybe do 3. Maybe if you increase the hardness, it's going to have a very sharp line. Or you could decrease the hardness and have it very feathered. It just depends on what the aesthetics are for the project you're working on. You could increase the spacing and have it much more stepped. See, like, individual dots, which might be an interesting idea. And then you could also go ahead and add an adjustment layer. You can add curves or things like that, color correction tools, or you could add a glow effect, for example. You could do something like that. Now for the glows, you probably do want to have the hue and saturation to be on a little higher. Otherwise the glow threshold won't be met. You wouldn't want more saturated colors. And then you want to reduce the intensity quite a lot, perhaps increase the radius, and then reduce the threshold. So that's beginning to look a little bit more interesting. I'm actually going to reduce that radius back to 10 and reduce the intensity even more. Since these are all 3D layers flying past the camera, we need to enable motion blur. So click on the switches for all these layers that move, hold that down, and then enable motion blur for the comp. So now when they fly past the camera, there'll be a little bit of motion blur on them, and that's what we want. And then what we can do, we can also animate the hue so that we can have all the letters change color gradually. So we could keyframe the master hue, so go over to the beginning, set a stopwatch for the channel range, and then go forward all the way to the end, perhaps, and then maybe we just say one full revolution. So this is the result that we've got. Obviously, there's way more things you could do with this and way more interesting things, but this is an introduction to the stroke effect and also how to use some master control layers and some simple expressions. So I hope you enjoyed that, and if you did, please subscribe, and there'll be more videos on the way soon. So thank you for watching. Have a good day.